Good morning, everyone. He is risen. Amen. Happy Easter to everyone as we gather this morning to worship our risen King, the Lord Jesus Christ, to celebrate our salvation together in and through him. Special welcome to guests and visitors who are today. I know I see some. Want to let you know that we're very glad to have you here. Also, just want to make mention of the fact that we are celebrating communion today, and it is open for all baptized followers of Jesus Christ, and I'll have a little bit more to say about how we do communion when we get to that point in the service, but we're glad you're here, and you're all welcome. We have a lot going on today, and a lot of really good things that we're thankful for today, so let me just run through the schedule and the announcements, a few announcements real briefly before we're called into worship. First of all, just a reminder that there is no fellowship time or Sunday school today after the service, but please feel free to mingle in the foyer for as long as you'd like. Just lock the door on your way out if you're the last one. Also want to make mention of the fact that I want to thank Ezra Vasquez for the artwork on the bulletin today. So we're very blessed by that. I'm not going to go through the schedule for this week. Just please take a look at it, and I'll just say, especially council members, remember that there is a meeting this coming Tuesday. But other than that, please take a look and see what's going on with the different studies and gatherings and all of that. I do want to remind you that officer nominations are due today in the clerk's mailbox. So if you have any of those yet to make, please do so today before you go. The men's breakfast for Saturday has been canceled. Because of the marriage retreat, which is also coming up. And so I just wanted to make mention of that. It is not too late to register if you've been on the fence about that. There are spaces still available, and information about how to register is in the bulletin. We have the delight today in the service of welcoming five young men and women into confessing membership here, and we look forward to that. And then also next week, we have the blessing of celebrating the sacrament of baptism as Jack Thomas is baptized. So again, a lot going on and a lot of things we're very thankful for. But I think those are all of the announcements that I have this morning. Would you please stand for our responsive call to worship? Christ is risen. Glory and honor, dominion and power be to our God forever and ever. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Let's join in singing. Thank you. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As God has greeted us, please take a moment to greet one another this morning.
Let no one caught in sin remain inside the lie of inward shame, but fix our eyes upon the cross and run to Him who showed great love and bled for us. Freely you bled is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with Him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. The weight of all our sin, you bow to none but heaven's will. No scheme of hell, no scoffer's crown, no burden great can hold you down. In strength you reign, forever let your church roar. Dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with Him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Oh, death, sting. Oh, hell, where is your victory? Oh, church, come stand in the light. The glory of God has defeated the night. Sing it now, oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, hell, where is your victory?
You may be seated.
The Apostle Paul writes, What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Let's pray. Most merciful Father, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, O Lord, forgive what we have been, help us amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Through our resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior and King. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Paul goes on and says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. And so know that we have that assurance and that promise that already Jesus in his resurrection power gives us new life through faith in him. And the promise is there for all who come to him by faith that he will indeed forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so praise be to our God and Father and the Lord Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, we have the distinct privilege today, as I said before, of welcoming new confessing members in today. And so, congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, today we are privileged to welcome into the full life of the church's fellowship those who wish to confess their faith in Christ as Lord and Savior. Our baptized members making profession of faith are Lily Duvall, Annie Main, and Landon Main. And coming into the church by their professions are Ethan Machen and Abby Smith. I'd like to invite each of these forward now. And as you come up, would you please just come up here? Wonderful. These five young men and women wish to share fully in the life of this congregation and of the whole Church of God. And so today they will publicly profess their faith in the Lord Jesus and offer themselves to God as his willing servants. We thank God for having given them this desire, and we pray that as we now hear their confession, Christ will favor us with the presence and guidance of his Holy Spirit. Lily, Ethan, Annie, Landon, and Abby. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God sent to redeem the world? Do you love and trust him as the one who saves you from your sin? And do you, with repentance and joy, embrace him as Lord of your life? If so, please respond saying, I do. Do you believe that the Bible is the Word of God, revealing Christ and his redemption, and that the confessions of this church faithfully reflect this revelation? If so, please respond saying, I do. Do you accept the gracious promises of God sealed to you in your baptism? And do you affirm your union with Christ and his church, which your baptism signifies? If so, please respond saying, I do. And finally, do you promise to do all you can with the help of the Holy Spirit to strengthen your love and commitment to Christ by sharing faithfully in the life of the church, honoring and submitting to its authority? And do you join with the people of God in doing the work of the Lord everywhere? If so, please respond saying, I do. Then in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I now welcome you to full participation in the life of the church. I welcome you to its responsibilities, its joys, and its sufferings. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, do you promise to love and support Lily, Ethan, Annie, Landon, and Abby with your prayers, with your encouragement, and by your example? If so, please respond saying, "We do, with God's help."
We do.
Let's pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word and spirit through which we know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. May your servants, Lily, Ethan, Annie, Landon, and Abby, who confessed your name today, and all of us here who have witnessed and received them, never cease to wonder at what you have done for us. Help us all to continue firmly in the faith, to bear witness to your love, and to let the Holy Spirit shape our lives. May we, with all your children everywhere, live together in the joy and power of your Holy Spirit. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in welcoming our members. You can sit down. The Lord bless you. 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 I'm going to invite the five of them to join me downstairs in the foyer after the service, and I invite you all to ignore me when I'm down there and give them a warm welcome as you exit today.
Stand and join us in worship.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
You may be seated.
Our law reading this morning is also from Romans 6, where I've been reading from already. This is verses 8 through 14. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. And therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under law, but under grace. God's gracious law to us this morning. Would you please join me in prayer? O Christ, in your resurrection, the heavens and the earth rejoice. Alleluia. By your resurrection, you broke open the gates of hell and destroyed sin and death. And so, O Lord, keep us victorious over sin. By your resurrection, you raised the dead and brought us from death to life. And so, O Lord, guide us in the way of eternal life. By your resurrection, you confounded your guards and executioners and filled the disciples with joy. And so, O Lord, give us joy in your service. By your resurrection, you proclaimed good news to the women and the apostles and brought salvation to the whole world. And so, O Lord, direct our lives as your new creation. God of mercy, we no longer look for Jesus among the dead, for he is alive and has become the Lord of life. From the waters of death, you raise us with him and renew your gift of life within us. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. And so, O Lord, draw near to each one today. Heal the injured in body or soul. Comfort the afflicted. Befriend the lonely. Encourage the fearful. Lift the spirits of the downcast. Fill the empty. Sustain the saved and save the lost. Through Christ our Lord, who died and rose victorious from the grave, who reigns forever and will come again, and who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time we'll receive our offering for the church and also today for the ministry of Discover Hope.
I know that my Redeemer lives. What hope this sweet assurance gives, that he who gave his life for me arose with healing in his wings. He lives, the tomb is empty still. Redemption's promise he fulfilled. No condemnation now remains. The stone of death is rolled away. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives on heaven's throne and in my very soul. I know that my Redeemer lives, and all my life is bound to his. In realms above he intercedes, our sinless Savior, perfect priest. No fear can follow where he guides, his constant presence is my light. No power on earth or heaven above can separate us from his love. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives on heaven's throne and in my very soul. I know that my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. In life and death I trust in him. My soul secure, my future safe. He'll not forsake me to the grave. He lives and he will not delay. My eyes will wake to brightest day. And in my flesh I'll see him stand when Christ in glory comes again. And every eye will see him stand when Christ in glory comes again. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives on heaven's throne and in my very soul. I know that my Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives on heaven's throne and in my very soul. I know that my Redeemer lives on heaven's throne and in my very soul.
I'd like to invite the children forward at this time for a special children's time today.
Hi, guys. I'm going to read you the Easter story. It's called God's Wonderful Surprise. Jesus' friends were sad. They would never see their best friend again. How could this happen? Wasn't Jesus the rescuer? The king God had promised? It wasn't supposed to end like this. Yes, but whoever said anything about the end? Just before sunrise on the third day, God sent an earthquake and an angel from heaven. When the guards saw the angel, they fell down with fright. The angel rolled the huge stone away, sat on top of it, and waited. At the first glimmer of dawn, Mary Magdalene and other women headed to the tomb to wash Jesus' body. The early morning sun slanted through the ancient olive trees, drops of dew glittering on leaves and grasses, little tears everywhere. The friends walked quietly along the hilly path through the olive groves until they reached the tomb and immediately noticed something odd. It was wide open. They peered through the opening into the dark tomb. But wait, Jesus' body was gone. And something else. A shining man was there with clothes made from lightning. Don't be scared, the angel said, but they couldn't help it. They screamed anyway. The angel asked them, "What are you doing here? This is a tomb, and tombs are for dead people." The women couldn't speak. "Jesus isn't dead anymore," he said. "He's alive again." And their hearts leapt. And then the angel laughed with such gladness that they felt for a moment as if they had woken from a nightmare. The other women rushed home, but Mary stayed behind. How could it be true? Jesus was definitely dead. How could he be alive? Just then, Mary heard someone else in the garden. Perhaps it's the gardener, she thought. He'll know where Jesus' body is. I don't know where Jesus is, Mary said urgently. I can't find him. But it was all right. Jesus knew where she was, and he had found her. Mary. Only one person said her name like that. She could hear her heart thumping. She turned around. She could just make out a figure. She shaded her eyes to see and thought she was dreaming. But she wasn't dreaming. She was seeing. Jesus! Mary fell to the ground. Sudden tears filled her eyes and great sobs shook her whole body. And all she wanted in that moment was to cling to Jesus and never let him go. You'll be able to hold on to me later, Mary, Jesus said gently, and always be close to me. But now, go and tell the others that I'm alive. Mary ran and ran all the way to the city. She had never run so fast or so far in all her life. She felt she could have run forever. She didn't even feel like her feet touched the ground. The sun seemed to be dancing and gleaming and bounding across the sky, racing with her and shining brighter than she could ever remember in the clear, fresh air. And it seemed to her that morning, as she ran, almost as if the whole world had been made anew, almost as if the whole world was singing for joy. The trees, tiny sounds in the grass, the birds, her heart. Was God really making everything sad come untrue? Was he making even death come untrue? She couldn't wait to tell Jesus' friends. They won't believe it, she laughed. She was right, of course. The end.
Thank you, Josie. Thank you for coming up. Now listen, I have something special for you today. And it's Huggies Wipes. And I also have chocolate eggs. So the one is for the other. So as you come down, you can come, maybe just come in a nice orderly fashion this way, and you can grab an egg, and I suggest you take a wipe back with you too to wash the chocolate and what's inside that off on your hands. So thank you all for coming up. You can come. Trust me, you can. You can come grab eggs now. Most of them are chocolate. There are a couple of caramel ones in there. All right. Thanks, everyone, for coming up. Parents, if they got back with an egg and no wipe, that's not on me. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day of celebration, this day of resurrection, of remembering the great power by which our Lord Jesus rose from the dead, victorious over sin and death and the devil. And we know that he now reigns forevermore. As we turn to your word and hear this story again, write it afresh on our hearts, change our lives by it, transform us more and more into the image and likeness of our beloved Lord and Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. The gospel we're turning to today for the story of the resurrection is John's gospel, John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. If you're following along in the Bibles in the pews, this is page 1685. We heard on Good Friday how Jesus took upon himself the curses of the previous covenants. He received the flogging at the pillar, and this was reminiscent of the flogging for disobedience that God pronounced in his covenant with David. We had the thorns in God's covenant with Adam in the crown of thorns pressed on Jesus' head. The rejection and casting out from among God's people in the covenant with Abraham, in Jesus' rejection by the people and the calls for him to be crucified rather than Barabbas. The curse of being hung on a tree under the Mosaic covenant, obviously this in the crucifixion of Jesus on another sort of tree, the cross. And then the sentence and punishment of shed blood for capital offenses under the Noahic covenant in Jesus' shed blood on the cross and in the spear thrust through his side and into his heart. And all of this is contained in the atonement. All of this is part of what Jesus was doing there in his suffering and in his crucifixion, taking upon himself these punishments for disobedience from what came beforehand, the covenants beforehand, even though he never disobeyed, even though he violated no covenant of God, even though he walked in perfect obedience and was without sin, still, he took these punishments upon himself. But because he, the perfect, sinless Son of God, was willing to endure this for us and for our salvation, God vindicated him and raised him from the dead on the third day. And so let's hear that glorious story once more today, again reading from John 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head, the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord. Jesus' suffering and his death on the cross show us how we are delivered from sin and death by the Lamb of God taking upon himself the curses of the other covenants. But we continue to be reminded of our deliverance in the story of his resurrection and this story at the empty tomb. We start here with Mary Magdalene. She's a very well-known woman from the Gospels, even though she doesn't appear very much in them. Yet everybody knows her name and they know of her, but so little space is given to her. In fact, in three of the four Gospels, she doesn't appear until the very end. Matthew, second to last chapter at Jesus' crucifixion. Mark, second to last chapter at Jesus' crucifixion. John, here, third to last chapter at Jesus' crucifixion. But Luke introduces her much earlier in chapter 8. And there we learn that Mary Magdalene actually traveled with Jesus and with the disciples, at least on occasion, maybe not always, but from the time that she encountered Jesus, there were times where she was with them and traveling along with others too, and even supporting them financially and materially in other ways. But we also learn something else about her there in Luke 8. Listen to what we read there. "After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out. Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household. Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means." And first at the tomb, on that resurrection morning, was this woman, Mary Magdalene, whom Jesus had delivered from demon possession, multiple demon possession. Now, what if the plan to destroy the Son of God had worked? What if the plot to have him killed, which he was, had accomplished the devil's higher goal of destroying the Son of God in every way so that he, Satan, could maintain his grip on the world as the ruler of this world, as he is referred to in the New Testament? What would we expect Mary Magdalene's condition to be right now, at that moment, 3 days after the death of the Son of God and his failure to defeat Satan, had that been the case? What would we expect? Well, I think we'd expect at least those 7 demons to have returned. And possibly, keying off of something Jesus says about going and grabbing others worse than themselves and coming back into a place that's been swept clean but not occupied, perhaps more than those 7 to have taken up residence in her once again. But you see, this didn't happen. That's not part of the story. It's not part of the truth and glory of that resurrection morning. Friday, at the 9th hour, 3 o'clock to you and me, when Jesus cried out and gave up his spirit, when he died, Mary was still free. And she remained free for the rest of that day. And all day Saturday, the Sabbath, while Jesus' body lay in a tomb and his spirit went to the place of the dead, Mary Magdalene remained free. And now, Sunday morning, at the tomb, Mary Magdalene is still free. The deliverance that she had experienced through the grace of God in Jesus Christ that Luke tells us about in chapter 8 of his gospel had not been reversed or undone. It was still very much intact. In fact, it hadn't waned in the least. She was every bit as free on Sunday as she was on Friday and in the days before that Friday and in the weeks and months and perhaps a year or two before that fateful day since her initial deliverance. Now, was she distraught? Yes, of course she was. But was she demon-possessed? Nope. Not anymore. Hadn't been since she met Jesus. And though she may not have fully understood all of this, maybe didn't connect the dots of what was going on here, she may not have understood why this was the case, it may not have been on her mind very much, if at all, still, Mary Magdalene had continued to walk in this freedom, in this deliverance, in this newness of life, even though Christ had been crucified, and really, because he had been crucified. Because he had suffered and died for the sins of the world and now had risen from the dead. Mary Magdalene, being first to the tomb of Jesus, the empty tomb of Jesus, speaks of this great deliverance accomplished in Jesus' death, now magnified in his resurrection. It was not undone. It was only stronger now. And finding the stone rolled away from the tomb and the tomb empty, she rushes to inform the disciples of what she has found, and Peter and John rush to the tomb, finding it just as she told them. And we read that they each went down into the tomb, Peter and then John. And John, when he saw, that is, when he saw the linen and the burial cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head and lying there in the tomb, we're told he believed. When he saw this. And I think the implication is his belief followed Peter's belief. Peter went down and saw, and he believed. And John went down and saw, and he believed. But strangely, they believed because of what they saw there, which was not Jesus. It was these cloths. It was the linens for the body and the wrap for his head. And we're told specifically they didn't yet understand from the scriptures, you know, they weren't connecting dots either. They didn't understand from the scriptures that Jesus had to rise from the dead. That wasn't on their minds, though they would understand that very soon. They hadn't seen Jesus yet. For all they know, what Mary said, Mary Magdalene, that's what the deal was. They took him, and we don't know where he went. But they went down and they saw the cloths and they believed. Why is that? I mean, what's the deal with the burial cloths? Well, I think this too points us to our deliverance, specifically from the power of death. And you see, this isn't the first time that we see in John's gospel the burial cloths of someone who was dead and then was alive again. Now, we didn't read that specific passage, but we recently talked about that specific person, and that person is Lazarus, the resurrection before the resurrection. Listen to this from John 11. This is sometime, you know, into the story, but so they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Linen strips and the burial cloth around his face. It's the same emphasis. The same emphasis given to these garments in the case of Lazarus as is given to the garments in the case of Jesus here in John 20. Some have speculated that the way in which they are positioned in Jesus' tomb signals to the disciples that Jesus too has risen from the dead. Perhaps they were laid in the same way. Remove those claws from Lazarus and let him go. Well, what happened to them afterwards? We don't know. Speculation, they were laid in there a certain way, and in Jesus' tomb, they're laid in the exact same way. We don't know that. We don't know that for sure. But there's some connection here. There's some connection here that they're seeing between these things. Perhaps the event was just so fresh in their minds that they're saying, this is just like Lazarus. Jesus has risen too. Either way, whatever it signaled specifically to them, the connection seems certain, and it signaled to them, and they came to understand what we come to understand, that the same one who delivered Lazarus from the grave has been delivered himself from the grave, and so his resurrection power to deliver them from the grave and to deliver us from the grave remains. And in fact, as I read earlier from Romans 6, in Jesus we are already raised, Paul writes, you know, of a sort, to new life, here and now. And he puts it even more directly in Colossians 3:1, where he says, since you have been raised with Christ. And then he goes on and makes his point. But since you have been raised with Christ, the empty tomb, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, is our deliverance unto resurrection now, and at the final resurrection unto eternal life. Well, Jesus wasn't there in that moment. And so Peter and John didn't stay at the tomb, but instead they returned home. But not Mary Magdalene. She lingered behind at the empty tomb. And so the passage begins with her and it ends with her. But not just her. Because Jesus does show up. And when he does, and when she recognizes him, his words to her are a glorious indication once again of the deliverance accomplished by his resurrection, as first indicated by the empty tomb and then those garments. Listen again to what he says. He said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Now, don't miss what he's saying there. First, because they believe in him, they are his brothers. Previously, he had said, "I no longer call you servants, but instead I have called you friends." Now he calls them brothers. And as if to emphasize this, he says, "I'm returning to my Father and your Father." They're the same. If they have the same father, then they're siblings, they're brothers. "I'm returning to my Father, who is your Father. I'm returning to my God, who is also your God." Jesus goes out of his way to make sure that they know and that we know that in him, we are the family of God. By faith in Jesus Christ, we are the brothers and sisters of the Lord, and we are the sons and daughters of God. In other words, John's account of the resurrection not only affirms who Jesus is, the Son of Man and the Son of God, but it also affirms who we are as children of God in Jesus Christ. We have been delivered from the family of the devil into the family of God. Now, that might seem like a harsh way to describe the situation of someone who comes to believe in Jesus Christ, to talk about the devil that way, but you have to remember, it was Jesus himself who identified this reality. He said to the Jewish leaders, "You belong to your father, the devil." And that the reason they didn't hear is that they didn't belong to God. They weren't members of the right family. And there's only two. Our greatest need, the greatest need of every single person, is to be delivered from the family of the devil to the family of God through Jesus Christ. And here at the empty tomb, Jesus assures us that in him, in his death and in his resurrection, this deliverance has been accomplished for all who come to him by faith. I'm going to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. And so this day of resurrection, we see, is this great and glorious day of deliverance. The empty tomb proclaims this deliverance. The disciples and the other witnesses proclaimed this deliverance. The church through all ages proclaims this deliverance. And our Lord himself proclaims this deliverance. He proclaims it to Mary Magdalene. He proclaims it to the disciples. And he proclaims it to us. And I'll close with the first verse of the hymn, The Day of Resurrection. The day of resurrection, earth tell it out abroad, the Passover of gladness, the Passover of God. From death to life eternal, from sin's dominion free, our Christ has brought us over with hymns of victory. Let's pray. Our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for winning the victory over sin and death and the devil, and for setting us free from all three. We thank you for our deliverance in your death and resurrection. We thank you that you reign glorious as King over all, King of all creation. Lord, please help us to live in this resurrection power that you have earned. Help us to walk accordingly. Since we have been raised with you by faith, Lord, help us and assist us by your Holy Spirit to love and serve you in thought, word, and deed throughout all our life. And we pray this in your glorious name. Amen. We're going to respond singing together hymn number 402, Alleluia, Alleluia, Give Thanks. Be seated. Well, Well, we come now to the table of the Lord. Just a couple words before we partake. The bread we will pass and then hold and then eat together, and then we'll do the same with the cups. We'll hold and drink together. Also, when these trays are passed, the outer ring is juice, and then everything inside that is wine. So take whichever you want. I think what is left to say before we celebrate the Lord's Supper is simply this. This is the Feast of Victory. Alleluia. Hear these words from the Apostle Paul. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." I'd like to invite the elders forward at this time. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord took bread and he gave thanks. And so let us pray. Blessed are you, King of the universe, for you have given us bread to strengthen our bodies. Blessed are you, Lord of all creation, for you have given us the true bread from heaven, even our Lord Jesus Christ. By his broken body, may we be renewed and strengthened in faith to serve you more fully and to love you more truly. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Jesus said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Therefore, take and eat, remember, believe, and rejoice that the body of our Lord was given for the complete forgiveness of all your sins." Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks. So let us pray. Blessed are you, King of the universe. We give you thanks for the gift of wine whereby our hearts are made glad. Blessed are you, Savior of the church, for you have given us the true wine, the blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. By it may we be refreshed and renewed to serve you all the days of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The cup for which we give thanks, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. Therefore, take and drink. Remember and believe that the blood of our Lord was shed for the complete forgiveness of all your sins." Well, let's continue worshiping and responding in joy as we sing number 396, "Lo, in the grave he lay." We'll sing to start with verses 1 and 2. Again, 396. Hear this word as you go out today. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. Go out and let that hope be planted firmly in your hearts and go out with his blessing as well. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace through Christ our Lord. Amen.